Welcome to Information Service Engineering. This is lecture number 3, Natural Language Processing, Part 2. In this section of the lecture, we are going to talk about regular expressions. So what are regular expressions? Regular expressions are so-called search patterns. It's a formal language with which you can define search patterns. And they are really famous or can be used in Unix tools. You know, Unix, the famous operating system, and there are some tools also pretty famous and popular still today, although they are decades old. They are working efficiently for text search, for example. You have grep, set, awk. So these are nice text processing tools, command line tools that you can use in the Unix operating system environment. But also regular expressions are part of programming languages like of Java, Python, .NET. So there you can also use them to filter and to search through text. They have already been introduced a long time ago. So 70 years ago, Stephen Cole Kleine, it's pronounced, this guy introduced regular expressions for the very first time. So who was he? He was an American mathematician, one of the students of Alonzo Church, probably know him from theoretical computer science. So he had also a model for computable systems, so for computability. And what Kleine did, he founded or co-founded a branch of mathematical logic known as recursion theory. And so he was working on the study of computable functions, and a number of mathematical concepts today are named after him, like for example the Kleine hierarchy, the Kleine algebra, or the Kleine star operator, the Kleine closure. So we will see this later on, also in the lecture. Coming back to his 1951 paper or work where he introduced these regular expressions, so what he did there is he was inventing regular expressions to describe neural networks. So Michalowicz have already introduced neural networks also in the late 1940s, so how a neuron works, and he used regular expressions to describe this. And this is interesting how the loop closes here, because we will of course then later on in the machine learning section of this lecture talk about the Michalowicz neuron. Okay, and the first time these regular expressions have been used for text search or pattern search, this was done by Kenneth Thompson in 1968. He also was a pioneer of computer science, and he was working most times at Bell Labs, most time for his career, and he designed and implemented the original Unix operating system. He also invented the B programming language, which was a predecessor of the C programming language you have probably heard of, and he was one of the creators and developers of the Plan 9 operating system, so nobody remembers this today anymore. However, now almost for two decades, he is working for Google, and there he also co-invented the Go programming language. So you see, these famous people have worked with regular expressions, and now we will do the same. So regular expressions are kind of an algebraic notation, and this simply specifies simple classes of strings. A string, you know, that is defined as a sequence of symbols from an alphabet. And regular expression search requires a pattern to be defined so that you can search with that pattern a corpus of texts. So like you see here in the example. And we have prepared for you, of course, some examples. You know already the Beethoven corpus. And there are very nice online tools, like here, for example, the RegExer tool that we have prepared for you, and where we can simply follow the link and then we can try out the stuff. And you see the stuff then also here as screenshot on the slide. So let's go to the RegExer application. You see that here on the web. So now by writing something in between these dashes, so I can write here, for example, Beethoven, you see exactly that this string then will be matched in the text or the corpus below. And now, of course, we can use specific patterns to make this exact match that you have here much more flexible. So what can we do, for example? Let's go back to our slide. What we can do after, of course, simply mapping Beethoven, we can, for example, look for disjunctions of patterns. So what we can do here, we can define disjunctions of single characters. So let's try to do that here. We have Beethoven, and what we want to do for the disjunction, we are using here these rectangle brackets. So let's take them here. And in between you write the things you want to disjunctively look for. So for example, we could say, let's look for the number 1, let's look for the number 9, and let's look for the number, 7 and 4. So you see here, you have lots of matches here in the line. You see here, what are the numbers matching that I found, and all of these numbers here then will be matched or mapped. So not only so the string 1974 would be matched, but all strings that contain any of these numbers you see here. You can do this, of course, also with, characters. So let's go for all of the vowels. A, E, I, O, U. So now you are matching all of the vowels you see here in the text, just as an example. Okay, that was disjunction. You can also express ranges if you don't want to now write in any number. So from 0 to 9, this of course would all single numbers or all digits to be included. So let's try this, for example, here I can write 0 to 9, and you see here all digits are included. The same probably holds for characters. So what we can do is we take lowercase character A to Z. You have all lowercase characters, or we can also then use all upper capital characters A to capital Z. And you see here now all capital characters are mapped. So it's also quite nice. Okay, what else can we do? So these were so-called range expressions. Of course, you can negate all kind of expressions. So in this example that you see here on the slide, we are looking for 199 and then anything but 2, so not 2, which means 1990 year and 1999, they both will be matched. And of course, if you are looking at the examples we have given here, so you can also combine range expressions, as you see here, with the negative expression, so which means not a lowercase letter, not an uppercase letter, or neither capital S nor lowercase s, or not a period. Periods are again special characters, and you have to take care to mask them with a backslash. We will come to that later on. Or if, and this is interesting, if in this range expression this hat is not the very first character, but it comes later, then of course the string hat will be matched. So you see here in the example E followed by a hat, you are looking here because this is a, again, range expression for E or the hat. Or a pattern, A hat B. It only works as a negation if it really comes first in place in our range expression. Then it's a negation. Okay, what else can we do? Negation, we can have wildcards. And here you see a period is a wildcard. If I use a period, then it's directly used as a wildcard. So let's take here something as a wildcard. What could we do, for example? Let's take Beethoven. But this is not so interesting. So the numbers are interesting. So let's take a number that starts with a 1. Then we have a wildcard. And then let's say 9, so, and another wild card. So you see then here 1990, 1999, and 1992 are, for example, taken as a wild card. Yeah, I could also do something else. So I could probably, I don't know. So simple a dot, wild card everything, you see then you match the entire text. Okay. What else? Repetitive pattern. So if I use the plus sign, this means the pattern after which the plus sign occurs, either a single character or an entire pattern of expressions, will repeat at least once, or will occur one or an arbitrary number of times from 1 to n. If you are writing a question mark behind a pattern, then this means this pattern occurs optionally, so it occurs not, or it occurs at most once. So we can again try this out for our Beethoven here in the Beethoven corpus. Let's take a plus here. Then you see Beethoven is always written here with 2e, so therefore this works out well. So I catch almost every line except the line where I have Beethoven with double T. If I want also double T, then I make a plus here too, then I also have this one. The only one I didn't catch here was Beethoven, the very last one with an E. Problem is here, if I include this one, yeah, I only have this one then, Beethoven. So I must make it optional, so I can use a, no, not that one, question mark, and you see, yeah, I hit it again. Okay, now I have all lines and I get all different writing forms and typos of Beethoven. So this is quite nice. Another shortcut, if you want to see for repetitions not between 1 and n times, but also include the optional, so repetitions from 0 to n times, you use the star. And with a star, you see here also, you can write a simple pattern that matches all writing styles of Beethoven in our entire corpus. One more thing are the so-called anchors you can use. If you use here the hat or the dollar sign, now without being here inside a range expression, then the hat matches the beginning of a line and the dollar sign the end of a line. And you can look here for Beethoven standing on the beginning of a line, and then of course you start with a hat and write then Beethoven, and only the line then will be matched where Beethoven stands in the beginning of the line. So this then is an anchor, beginning or end of a line. What else do we have? We have disjunctions. So this is a vertical bar between two expressions, and this here you match the string Vienna or Bonn. So this is a disjunction of strings. And one more thing what you can do, you can use here these curly braces you have here, or curly brackets, and with them you can indicate repetitions. So you have to write a number inside these brackets, and then you have you can repeat it n times according to the number n you write there. So here in this example, what I have here, I have a number expression, so it ranges between 0 and 9, and this should be repeated 4 times, which means I get every year that has been mentioned here in this text, because years are a 4-digit number, so I get every 4-digit number back here. I can also define here repeat patterns from n to m times, so this means at least n times, at most m times, and also if I use here a comma, I can say it should be repeated at least n times. So I have different varieties to continue there. Some of these expressions that you use here are special characters that have a function, and if you are looking for them in a search expression without using this kind of a functionality, you have to mask them. And the mask character here, this is the backslash character. This means if you're looking for an asterisk, you write backslash asterisk. If you're looking for a period, like at the end of a sentence, you're looking for backslash period. For a question mark, since this means optional or not, if you're looking for a question mark in text, you have to backslash the question mark. The same is for a new line, because it doesn't occur. This is backslash n for a new line, backslash t for a tab, and backslash comma for a comma that you are looking for. And then, of course, there are some, let's say, advanced operators or shortcuts for already existing stuff. So for that regular expression backslash d, you catch any digit with backslash capital D. What you are getting there is any non-digit. And it's the same with backslash W, you get any alphanumeric character plus underscores, or backslash capital W, then you get any non-alphanumeric character. And then the same for backslash small s, you get all white spaces. For backslash capital S, you get all non-white spaces. And the numeric ranges we have already talked about that. So with the asterisk, you get zero or more occurrences of the previous character or expression, plus one or more, question mark, exactly zero or one. And then you have these patterns that we have already talked about, which is then n repetitions or from m, n to m, or at least n occurrences. So simply play around with these kind of expressions, and then you can probably also try to get a better solution for the experiment that we had in the beginning. However, we have to look at some of the applications in natural language processing. What can I do there with these regular expressions? And of course, I can detect synonyms or variations of words. You know, usually if you are searching, let's say, for the occurrences of an entity, for all occurrences of an entity in a text, what we have to consider, of course, is spelling variations or synonyms of exactly this kind of name. With the real synonyms, of course, then I have to use an OR and have to look for, yeah, if I look for mobile phone, for example, I also have to consider cell phone or cellular phone. Then there are so-called quasi-synonyms, which means, yeah, this is something quite similar. It's not an exact match, but a mobile can also something else, but we have to look for, because sometimes it's referred to as a mobile phone or a flip phone, for example. Simple variations, uppercase variation, for example, cell phone can be written with a capital or with a lower first letter, which means this kind of variations can easily be captured with regular expressions. Or other kind of orthographic variations. Some people write cell phone, why ever, with a dash in between, some don't. So we have to consider both spelling variations, one with a dash, one without a dash. Or we have to consider plural forms. Usually in English, plural, okay, you simply add an S and we can catch this with a regular expression. Or typographic errors. So like cell phone, you can look for cellular phone or anything like that. Of course, included in a list of, you know, disjunctively connected expressions and variations. And then this, of course, will be matched within a regular expression. And if you spin this further, you might also look for related topics which are, let's say, syntactically similar. And then you look for cell phone, video, cellular, radio, phone carrier, or what else. But you can connect this then in your search patterns. But the most straightforward things that you can do with regular expressions are here the red ones. So you can look for variations or for inflections, for example, plural forms or typographic errors. So this is easily done with regular expressions. Okay, let's go back to our experiment, to the Beethoven corpus, and we want to identify sentences that really refer to Ludwig van Beethoven. I have here proposed another algorithm, which is now a regular expression match with the following expression. We have here Beethoven, which means B, E, then another E, followed by an asterisk, which means this second E occurs zero or n times. So I go for all variations of that. And then I look for T, and T can be there once or also many times. So at least one variation, at least one repetition of T, so one occurrence or n occurrences. And then comes Hofen. So let's see what's the match there. And with that, if I do exactly this kind of match, we can try it out again. So Beethoven, let's try to do this again here in our regular expression live. So we have here Beethoven, so this we don't want to match. And you see here we have lots of matches, so all lines basically match except the very last one. So let's see now if we are creating then for that the confusion matrix. And in the confusion matrix, what you see then there, from we have identified 11 lines as positive. These are from 1 to 11, and only one line as negative. This is line number 12. So line number 12 is really a true negative. So we have actual false, predicted false 1. And we have 8 of the lines that are matching that are actual positive. So they are true positives. So 8 true positive, 1 true negative. And then the rest, if we look at it, we have 3 false positives and 0 false negatives. Looking at precision and recall now again, we will see that precision here computes to 72.7% and recall computes to 100%, which in the end, harmonic mean of both comes to an F1 measure of 84.2%, which is already rather high. So you see, by using regular expressions, we can really improve that kind of, let's say, search task and search experiment that we want to do. Now, question to you, can you come up with a regular expression that obtains an F measure of 100% for the Beethoven corpus? Try it out. However, if so, will this then be the perfect Beethoven classifier for any arbitrary unknown Beethoven text? Think about it. And of course, we can discuss it then also later offline in the course. So, now the next topic in the lecture will be finite state automata. So this is an interesting mathematical, let's say, concept, which is able to apply or really compute regular expressions with a mathematical model. So this will be then finite state automata. And we will see then also in the further course of the next lecture how finite state automata will be extended to so-called finite state transducers and how you can use then these interesting automata, these finite machines, for morphological parsing, which will be our first major task in the lecture.